Hey guys, Artcast 346. Sitting here waiting for the heater to go off, and it's taking forever, so I'm just gonna start. Sorry I jumped off yesterday. I had to run to the, I just had all this stuff to do, and I had to actually do it between, like, I had to take the car while Tanya was home. So, like, when Tanya got home from picking up Tristan to the time that Tristan had to go to gymnastics, I had to rush around and rush out to my dad's house and all this kind of stuff. So I actually had to leave, and that was the only time I had was to record the Artcast was right then. So there was just no hanging around. But I was talking about kind of failing at art, and when I tried to get back into comics kind of around like the early sort of 2000s, and I went out to San Diego and there was just no work, and there was no kind of obvious path to get work. I'm sure there's work at all times, but I couldn't figure out how to get it. And I came back, and I can't remember everything I did at that time. I know I got some like indie comics work, like I was saying, and it paid like really shitty. And you know, it's just like at that time, you know, people were starting to do print on demand type stuff, and so like everybody was starting their own comic book company. And you just run into these guys who were like, you know, they had sort of like big plans, and then you know, that just amounted to kind of nothing, and they'd disappear, and they wouldn't pay you for your work, and it was just bad. And I got to the point where I just was like, I had no money. You know what I mean? And then also what actually happened then too, which this is kind of a funny story, but I had gotten audited a few years before, leaving my job and stuff. This was when I was still working as a delivery driver, and we were all like subcontractors, so I worked for myself at that point. And so I had gotten audited for, I don't remember, I made a mistake on my state taxes or something, and it was just a mistake. I wasn't trying to rip anybody off, but of course, you know, like when you get audited, you know, they're asking about like stuff that happened, you know, 3 years ago. I mean, it was just like, I don't know, you can't fight them. So I just agreed to pay, and I can't remember what I had to pay, you know, like $5,000 or something. I didn't have it. So I was paying it on like these monthly installments, you know. And when I was not working, you know, we were just kind of getting broker and broker and broker. And we'd actually moved down. We had a house up in the mountains in this town called Ward, which was really cool. And didn't have that anymore, and it just was like everything was really kind of going bad and going downhill, and I needed like to work. And like the last kind of nail in the coffin was I missed a payment on the the IRS thing, and they sent me a letter and pretty much said, like, you know, we're seizing your bank account and taking our money out because you defaulted on your payments. And that was like all our money, you know. It was like all of our money. And then what was really the bad part was my dad had an account with my name on it at the time, just because I don't even remember why. It probably had something to do with like the cattle and stuff from a long time ago, but I just kind of had forgot, you know, never bothered to take it off. And so anyway, they went in and they got all of my money. And then they went and took like the rest that I didn't have out of his account. So I not only lost my money to, you know, lost all of our money to the IRS, I also, you know, went into debt to my dad for, you know, $1,000 or something. It was just ridiculous, you know. But it was like one of those moments where like, oh my God, what are we gonna do now? We have like $0, you know. We were already broke, but now we have literally, like, we don't even have money for dinner tonight kind of a thing. And that's actually when I started painting houses. I just went in, I opened up the paper, and I was just like, I gotta work somewhere. And it wasn't even that much of an experienced painter at that point. I had painted like a couple summers with my brother when I was younger, and so I kind of knew about it. And I didn't even, you know, I wasn't even looking for like a painting job necessarily. I was just looking for like any kind of job. And it was springtime, so of course like construction was starting up. And there was just, you know, in the paper there was ads for, you know, inexperienced painters. And I just called up a couple of them, and like the second guy or third guy I called was like, you know, yeah, we need somebody, you know, can you come like now? Because that's always how construction is in the springtime, you know, when things are hot, it's like they just need bodies, you know, they just need people to sand and stuff. And I was like, I'll be there. And that's how I started painting like years ago. But like, I guess my point is, you know, it's like, that's kind of like a bummer story, because you kind of like leave your job and you're like hopeful and you're like, I'm gonna make it work, you know. But it's like, I didn't have a plan to make it work. You know, I didn't really know. I had kind of a sort of half-assed plan that had sort of worked before. Because, like, I did actually work in comics before. So I did make my living for, like, about 4 years, just nothing but, like, freelance work. But that was years ago, you know. And so I was kind of like, that could work again, but I wasn't sure. So I didn't really have, you know, I didn't really have like a solid, like, okay, this is how it's going to work. I'm going to replace this with this, you know. It was more kind of like one of these, okay, I'm a leap of faith kind of things, you know. But, you know, when it all kind of failed, and, you know, I was back at work and back at a different work, you know, doing a different kind of job, I didn't look at it like a failure. I don't think you can ever look at it like a failure. It was just like, I mean, it's a failure, but it's not, like, it's just, like, I tried it right there, and, you know, like, everything went to hell, and I had to, you know, pull the ripcord before, like, the plane crashed into the volcano kind of thing, and then, you know, and I got myself out of it, and, you know, and then I kind of just, I lay low again for a while, and I kind of get my bearings, and I get a new plan, you know what I mean, and then I go for it again, you know. And, you know, like, just going on with that whole scenario, that story, like, once I got into painting, I was kind of like, you know, I had never really been in construction to any sort of, like, real extent before. I mean, I'd you know, painted for a couple summers, like, when, you know, me and my brother was younger, and that was kind of it. But, like, once I got into painting, it's like I realized, well, like, it's almost the same deal. It's like you're not going to make any money working for someone. You know, it's like the only guy making money is the guy writing me a check, you know. And so it's like I almost immediately, you know, not immediately, but within like 2 years, I started my own painting company, because I realized, like, you know, I can make $500 a week, or I can hire three guys and make, you know, four times that, you know what I mean? So, you know, it's like it wasn't going back into art, but it was also like, it was kind of the same scenario where, like, you know, you start to look around and you kind of, you know, plot and plan and I mean, that's the benefit, I guess, of like when you're back at your job, is you have that. You don't have time to do your art necessarily, but you have time to think. You know what I mean? You have time to plan and sort of figure out, like, how, I mean, to figure out how it's going to work when you go for it again, when you climb that fence again. You know? And every time I've done it, it's always like I come, like, you know, like, I, you know, like you climb the fence. It's like I climb the fence with, like, a new plan or more of a plan, I guess. You know what I mean? It's not so much like a leap of faith. Like this last time, to me, wasn't as much of a leap of faith. You never know. You really never know what's gonna kind of wait out there. But I'd already kind of done this. You know, tried to like made my living on the web doing art one time before with the sketch cards. and I'm sure I've told that story before, but I this was kind of when I had my painting company. So this was like, you know, if you go on further down in the story, I had my painting company. I never had a huge one. I just had one that made me enough money. So it's like, I think the most people I ever had working for me was like four, and at the time I had two people working for me, and they were like a husband and wife, and they were really cool, and they had decided to move to Hawaii. They just had this wild hair. They wanted to move to Hawaii, and it was like the winter time, and like work was slowing down, and that's when they were gonna go. So I was like, oh, okay, that's cool. And I had sold some stuff on the web. I had sold some nudes. Finally, I'd found like a place to, you know, sell them at auction. And so I kind of had, you know, I'd been kind of wanting to do it, but you know, I was more entrenched in my business at that point. I didn't want to, you know, because I had like Derek and Janelle, and I didn't want to like leave them without a job. You know what I mean? But then like when they decided to, you know, take off and go to Hawaii, it was like it was just me. And I just started thinking, well, God, you know, it's like, maybe I should try it right now when I don't have, you know, the only people I'd be kind of letting down is like my regular clients, and I wouldn't be really letting them down. It would just be like, they just have to find another painter, you know what I mean? And so, that winter, when everything kind of really grinds to a halt in Colorado for painting, I just kind of turned my phone off and started painting like hell and enlisting as many of those nudes as I could. And it worked that time too. And you know, like, I say nudes, but then, like, soon after that I found, like, the sketch card market, and that was hot, and I think it's still hot, and I just, started selling sketch cards, sketch card prints, and all that. So, like, anyway, the point of that is just, you know, like, so I'd already kind of been out there, I'd made my living just exclusively on the web for, you know, a few years there, and then like I managed to get myself back in a job again. And so like the second time when I left, it was more like, you know, I had an idea. It's like I figured I could probably make it work again, you know, either doing sketch cards or, you know, just art or whatever. And that's you know, that's what happened. But each time it's like you get like more stuff in your arsenal, I think. And I think that's just like so important, is like that planning type thing. Like, and that's something I learned later on, because I think when you're younger, it is more of like this, well, I'm just gonna fucking go for it. I'm just gonna move to wherever, and you know, it's either gonna work or it's not, you know, and you're more brave. But you have like way less of a plan. But you know, if you had a plan, if you had kind of like, you know, experimented with that market or wherever, you know, you're going or whatever, you know, it's like there's it just increases your chances for success. And each time I left my, you know, job, and you know, this is pretty much just talking about like, you know, with the web and stuff, it's like I learned more about like where you can make money, you know. So it's like the print thing is a good example. YouTube's a good example, you know what I mean? Now Patreon makes me a little money. It like expands your base, so you're not so just dependent on this. If this one thing works, you know what I mean? And if you can get like one thing working though, like when you're starting, you know, it's like you can, it's like if you sell one piece, you probably can sell two pieces, you know. If you sell like two pieces, you probably can sell 10 pieces. And you know, or even if like, you know, you can make prints and, you know, it's the same thing. It's like if you can just get one print sale somewhere, well, it's like that works. So it's like, how do you expand on that? How do you make that bigger? Or even like with Patreon, that's something I've been thinking about lately. It's like, you know, it's like I got to a certain level with Patreon. Can I actually get that to go up and make that a bigger level? If I concentrated on it more, if I thought about it more, maybe, you know. Where was I going with all this? I don't know. Oh, I was talking about the guys who are having trouble with their businesses or you know, have kind of went through some failure or whatever. And I wanted to encourage them, because it's like, you know, like I told you some of mine, that's not all of them. You know, I failed a lot more times than that. And they weren't all big, like I'm quitting my job and blah, blah, blah. A lot of them were just things that I had tried But you don't know until you try. And the other thing is, like, once you try, then you do actually know. Then you do actually kind of have some, like, real info. It's not just, like, listening to, you know, whoever, like, Jake Parker tell you how to make a living, you know what I mean? Or some of these other guys who are, like, real popular, and they have all the answers about everything, and this is how you're supposed to do this, and this is how you're supposed to do that. Because, like, when you really get out into it and you try this stuff, a lot of that stuff, you know, it's, like, it's specific to them. You know, it's not necessarily specific to everybody, you know? It's, like, this guy can make that work because he has this kind of quality. And you put that same thing, that same business model, over top of somebody that doesn't do that one thing that he does as well, and it doesn't work right. You know what I mean? Or maybe it's just, like, there's, you know, other things beyond just the quality that he has, like a quality of luck, you know, of timing, of all that kind of stuff, you know? I think that, you know, when I look back at the, like, the webcomics guys, the ones who really kind of exploded and were, you know, doing the podcasts and all that kind of stuff, and really were sort of those leaders for, like, you know, you can make a living at webcomics and stuff. I think a lot of those guys had, like, timing on their side, you know? It wasn't so much that they were geniuses or something, you know what I mean? I'm sure that they're, you know, I'm sure they're smart enough, but I think there's a ton of luck involved, you know, with why one, say, webcomic goes and one doesn't, you know what I mean? Just like one guy on YouTube goes and one doesn't and things like that. I don't know if I got off topic there, but I don't think you should ever look at it as failure, though. It's just another, it's just more experience to learn from, you know what I mean? And I mean, I know for myself, because it's like, you know, nothing's guaranteed. Like, nothing is guaranteed. I mean, I can go broke, like, next month and have to go to some job or something, you know what I mean? And it might happen, it might not, I don't know. I'm going to try to keep it from happening, but it's like, there's a lot of stuff you can't control, a lot of variables, you know? But it's like, if it happens, like, I know myself, and, you know, I'm like 40 years old, I'm so past it, I'm so over the hill, and I still fucking try it, you know what I mean? I never get, like, to the point where I'm like, I can't do it no more, you know what I mean? I'm just like, I'm done, I'm just going to be a normal fucking person and all that kind of shit. Because I'm not a normal person. Nobody that watches this show, that's listening to this show probably right now, is like a normal person. We're all weirdos, you know what I mean? We all have that, whatever it is, that one gene that is wrong in us that just makes us want to do something, you know, creative or whatever, or, you know, that just makes us unsatisfied with, like, you know, a job at wherever, you know, 7-Eleven or IBM or whatever, you know, it doesn't matter. We just don't want people telling us what to do, maybe. I don't know. But there's something weird about us. And you can't ever turn that off. So, you know, you either squash it down, you know, and try to pretend it's not there, or continue to do these crazy things that, you know, mess your life up every now and then. But yeah, it's like, if I ended up back in another job, you know, I can almost guarantee you I might be gone from YouTube for a while. I might be, you know, I might be, you know, disappear off the web for a while. But it's like, eventually I would be back on here, you know, bugging you guys, telling you what my new plan is. And that's just how it is. That's just how it is. And the next time around would be, I'd be a little bit smarter. So maybe the next time around I'd have enough info to make it work. I named the first show, like, The Great Escape. And I was thinking, like, yesterday, like, I of course hadn't recorded this, but I was thinking about this documentary that I had seen about, it was like, you know, like one of those shows, like the true story of The Great Escape, you know, the movie The Great Escape with, like, Steve McQueen. That's like, I love that movie. I don't know if it's one of my favorite movies, but it's definitely up there. And it's an inspiring movie, you know what I mean? If you go watch it, I don't know how many you guys have, but it's super dated, you know, when you watch it. But it's like, you know, once you get into it, It's so cool because it always reminds me of like when I'm getting ready to quit, when I'm getting ready to take the chance, you know. Because like that's what those guys are, you know, they're stuck in like jail or whatever, in like the prison camps, and they're like, you know, there's no, it's like, what else are they gonna do? They're just either gonna sit there and do nothing, or they're gonna try to get out. And that's sort of like me. It's like, well, what else am I gonna do? You know, if I'm working for somebody, it's like, I'm not just gonna like take it. Of course I'm gonna try to escape in it. And I don't know, that's what that whole movie is about. But anyway, like when you watch this the documentary I was actually talking about, like the real story of those guys, I really got inspired by, because like the whole thing is like based on a true story, and it's really cool to watch. You guys should actually search it and try to find it on YouTube, because I'm sure that's where I watched it. And it's like these archaeologists, and they actually go to Germany and find this prison camp where these guys were held, and they start digging it up with like a backhoe, and they actually find like one of the tunnels that those guys dug, and all that kind of stuff, you know. It's just really neat. And then they actually have some of the guys that were there come, and you know, they're there at the dig, you know, and it's just neat. It's super cool. And you know, like just to hear like how innovative those dudes were, you know, and it all has to do with like, it's kind of the same thing, which I know, like, I'm not in a prison camp when I go to work and stuff like that. But just the fact that those guys, like, they use their minds to like figure out the things, like, even though they didn't have any access to anything, you know what I mean? They used their brains to like put this stuff together. Like they used they took the slats out of their beds and they used it to shore up the tunnels. They dug like three tunnels, and I think they named them Tom, Dick, and Harry, I think. And you know, it's like once you dug down like so deep in this soil underneath this prison camp, you know, it's like it just turned to sand. So like when they dig through the sand, it would just collapse. So they had to shore it up. So they used all their, you know, the slats out of their beds, because, you know, they needed wood to like, you know, shore up the tunnels. And then they you know, they also took like, you know, other wood that they couldn't, you know, like out of the attic of the sheds or whatever they were living in. And and it's like a lot in the movies, you know, like they took the sand and they all had like gardens there, like they cultivated gardens, and then they put like socks in their pants, and then they have little strings in their pockets so that they put their hands in their pockets and walk out to the garden, walk around the garden, and then pull the strings, and then the sand would drop out of the socks that's sort of down in their pant legs. And then, you know, the guys are out there raking gardens, so then they just rake the sand in with the soil. So they could get rid of the sand, like, so that, you know, there's just not a giant pile of sand around. And I don't know, there's just like so much stuff. Then and then they got, the tunnel was like so long, or one of them was, that it got so that they couldn't keep their lamps lit. And they made their own little lamps. They used like bacon fat and like put a little piece of string in it, and then they would make a little lantern that could burn. And so, like, you know, they tunneled out so far that they you know, it got so far out there that they couldn't get enough oxygen to keep the lamps going. And so they built a pump, like a wooden box with it looked kind of like a tarp kind of thing, and a guy would sit there and pump it like this, and it would pump air down that thing, you know. I mean, this is just nuts, you know, all while like the guards are like watching them, and you know, could shoot them if they catch wind of this shit. And I think like the best part of the whole thing is, I guess I shouldn't like tell you, because just in case you watch it, but I don't know who's gonna really go look it up anyway. I'll just go ahead. The best part of the whole thing though is the guards started to know something was up. There was so much shit disappearing from the camps for this tunnel that they were like, they have to be digging somewhere. And I think they actually, like, the entrance to the tunnel, I'm pretty sure it was like under like a toilet or something, so like they couldn't find the entrance either. But anyway, the Germans knew something was up, and so they had three tunnels going. So they let the Germans find one of the tunnels. And so then, you know, the Germans are, you know, they find the tunnels, they throw the guys they think's responsible in like solitary confinement, And, you know, they're partying it up and taking pictures of themselves going through the tunnels and all that kind of stuff. But they still had the two tunnels going, you know. And then they got to the point where they were like, we still can't get rid of enough dirt. So then they backfilled, like, the second tunnel so that they could keep going with the first tunnel. And I'm just like, you know, it's like, that's just, you know, just awesome. It's just amazing that they did it. And in the end, you know, it was like, I think three guys made it. Like, out of, like, the however many went. I think they were planning on getting, like, 250 guys out. And they only got, I think they only got, like, I can't remember. It's been so long since I watched it. But it was something like 70 guys or something. Because eventually, as they were going out the tunnel, somebody spotted them popping their heads up. And so, like, part of the guys never got out. And, you know, they took off, and, you know, a lot of, like, why they went with so many is because they wanted, like, these certain guys to make it out. And a lot of the guys were just sort of meant to be, you know, they were meant to, like, scatter the Germans and, like, you know, mess up their resources when they're trying to catch those other guys, you know. And I don't know, man, but it's just, like, three guys, you know, actually made it out. And I don't know, it's like, you know, like I said, it's like, I know, you know, it's like when I left my job, it's not leaving a prison camp and all that kind of stuff, but it's like, it's that kind of mentality. It's like, you're never satisfied, you know. It's like when you're working that job and you know, going to work and being like the good citizen and all that kind of shit, it's like, you know, it's secret at night, you're making your plans, you're digging your tunnel, you know what I mean? It's like, and that's how it is, man, when you're an artist. It's like, you can never quit that. That's what makes it worth it. Even when you fail, even when you fucking fail and you got to go back and you're back in, you know, solitary or whatever, and you're back at your job and you're, you know, and all the guys are fucking, you know, like, shaking their head, being like, oh yeah, we knew you'd be back, we knew you'd be back. It doesn't matter, because, like, you know, you just start digging that tunnel again, man. You start figuring out, like, if that didn't work, well, what the fuck works? There's an answer there. You know what I mean? There's a way to figure that out. And I'm not even done, you know? It's like I found my answer for, like, this, but I am constantly looking. I'm constantly, like, trying to figure out, like, what is the answer to really solidify this? You know what I mean? That's like, I built my little sandcastle. Now, how do I make it into concrete? You know what I mean? How do I make it so that I have, like, that, the passive income and stuff like that, so when, you know, like, the big wind comes along, it can't blow me down. I don't know. Is that inspiring to you guys? I hope it is. I wanted to, like, kind of make a video because, like, I messaged some of those dudes back and I was kind of like, you know, just keep going. But it's like, how long of an email am I going to write, you know? But, you know, anybody that's got the fucking nerve to, like, to try it anyway, or even try it in, like, a little bit of a way, you know, even if you don't leave your job and it's like, this is what you want to do, and you're trying stuff, trying to make it work, it's like, that's worth it, you know. That's commendable, you know. Keep fucking trying. Might not work, you know what I mean? It's like, three guys got out of that fucking prison camp. For, like, a lot of guys, it never worked for them, but for three guys it did work. I don't know. It kind of goes back to that whole thing. Is it, like, the battle, or is it the or what do you call it? Is it the journey, or is it the end result kind of thing? That's what I'm talking about. Is it the prize that you get in the end, or is it just the fact that, you know, you fought the fight, you know? I think it's actually just the fight to fight. Because really and truly, there's nothing, you know, there's nothing at the end of most things. Even when you're successful, it's just, there's just another mountain to climb behind the mountain you just climbed. So, but I don't know. Anyway, thanks for watching, guys. Check out Patreon if you want to help me out, or maybe buy some prints or something. And I appreciate all that kind of stuff. See you guys next time.